get to going here. As I kind of stated in my prayer, we are here to worship Jesus Christ first and foremost. I have many great memories of my mama praising Jesus. And those things have sustained me through my years of life when times got tough. We're here to celebrate her life today. We're here to thank God that she knew him. And that she wasn't afraid to share that with other people. That she wasn't going to hide her light under a bushel. That she was a bold believer. I want to just give you time to just reflect a little bit. We've already had one prayer. I don't think we need to pray again. But I wanted to take time to reflect a little bit. And I think if they're about ready for my first song, I want you to listen to this first song. And I know Mom had a little bit different way of worshiping. But I think that she would be okay with what I've picked. It's a little newer version of something old. And we just rest our heart on that Rock of Ages today.
To the King of the Ages. this will be my song forever. Yeah, this will be my song forever. Oh, Rock of Ages, clap for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Through the dark and through the storm, I'll be safe and warm. Oh, Rock of Ages, clap for me. In the Rock of Ages, in the Rock of Ages, in the Rock of Ages, in the Rock of Ages.
I think Mom would say hallelujah to that. I remember Mom and Dad being real shouting type people when they got really happy. Amens and hallelujahs are easy for them. I address my family at this moment. Thank you, know I love you. I'm proud of my sister. She lived a long time. Accomplished a whole lot. Had two boys of her own. And watch them boys live with me when I was still trying to grow up and get out away from home. Because Mama loved them boys too. Mama couldn't turn kids away, man. She loved children. I love Dwayne. He's been a pretty faithful brother through the years. We've had our times in the past that we've probably soon forget about things that when we were younger, but we also know that we've grown up and we know how important Mom and Dad were to us. And today we look at Mom and think, you know, what she has accomplished to get to this point. I kind of shared this when Dad passed away. I know that Mom and Dad were married in 1952. They were married 63 years. That's quite remarkable. They taught us the value of marriage and family, and I know Jan and myself never had any children of our own, but we love everybody else's kids. We try to do the best we can. Patty came along in 1954. Dad had been a service member in the Army, and Mom had stayed home to give birth to Patty, and Dad couldn't wait to get back home, I'm sure, because now he was a daddy. Not long after that, a little over a year and a half later, I guess Carl came along in 1955, and suddenly they were a multiple family very early on in their marriage. In 3 years, they struggled. They had a hard time. They lived in small homes and roughed it, and I know Patty and Carl can remember things that I can't remember. And if you think about those things when this happens. Dwayne came along on Christmas Day in 1958. He was the third child. and Mom got her a Christmas present and also probably a bunch of snow from what I remember from the stories I've been told. I wasn't there yet. And somehow I just don't think they planned on having me, but I just think things kind of circumstances kind of caused it. I've kind of traced me being born to the fact that John F. Kennedy was assassinated, and Mom and Dad probably drew close during that time and during that political unrest and all the things that were going on during that time. And then I was born in 1964. Many things transpired, but we had a loving home. Mom and Dad, while they were still young and vibrant, they were playful. I remember us having very wonderful, playful time in the yard and almost having family reunions and riding bicycles and playing ball games, and you just couldn't ask for anything any better. I mean, sometimes during the summer we would be out in the yard with no lights on. You know, if the moon was bright enough, we'd be out in the yard we into the hours of the night playing, and didn't nobody want to go to bed, you know. And we had that kind of fun at home, and I'm grateful for that. But I'm particularly grateful that Mom and Dad made a huge decision on Easter Sunday of 1966. Dad would like to sit at home and occasionally, you know, have a sip of a refreshment. I don't think we should be fooling with these days, but we've all done those things. And I know Dad said every time he popped the can, he said, "Here come that Baptist preacher." And Baptist preacher got to him, and Mom, the kids went to Vacation Bible School, and next thing we know, we was at Mount Pleasant Baptist Church. And then on Easter Sunday of 1966, Mom and Dad gave their life permanently to the Lord Jesus Christ, and thus changed our family forever. I'm grateful for that today. And I thank you all for being here today. I know that it's difficult for many folks in these days and times, and my heart goes out to everyone. When I share with you here at this moment, I want you just to stop and think. We're going to play one more song, and then I'm going to get into the message. I just want you to just stop and think. There is a world beyond this world. There are creatures we have not seen. There are heavenly hosts. There are angels hovering around us, and we do not realize them. There are angels gathered around the throne of the Almighty God, singing praises to Him every moment throughout eternity. There is a world beyond this world. There are two worlds. There is this physical world that will vanish away. It will vanish like a vapor. But there is a world that is eternal that is coming. And this soul that we celebrate today belongs to the next world. And I want us to think about that as we listen to this song.
Never here to awake again, but everything was all right between her and him. So she awoke in heaven's courtyard, free from pain within. The angels gathered around her, and they took her by the hand, serenaded by angels, up to the throne, serenaded by angels. By praises to the King. Welcome to paradise, the angels will see. Now I close my eyes at night, and I try to imagine that city of brilliant light waiting for me. But my mind cannot conceive, so I'll continue to dream till I'm transported there. Then I will be serenaded by angels up to the throne, serenaded by angels, finally at home, surrounded by
first time I ever heard that song, many times I thought of my mother, because it's just the way I felt about her. It's just the way I loved her. Just on a personal note, I used to go out and get into things and do things and drive fast cars and have wrecks. And Mom used to tell me, I'd be in the hospital in the emergency room, and she'd tell me, she says, every time that happened, she says, I would just sit up in the bed and start praying. Knew something was going on. I know I had my aunt praying for me. I remember Uncle Buford knew praying for me, and all the family, and Jimmy Lee, I know all of y'all have prayed for us. God has sustained us. And we can praise God today that this soul belongs to Jesus. I want to encourage you today by telling you that my mother has enjoyed the best of both worlds. She got to know Jesus on this side, and she's going to get to live with him on the other. Amen. You see, the child of God can have the best of two separate worlds. Frequently, we will hear others say to one another, "Do whatever you think best," or "I wish the best for you." The best, as many people may understand, does not always appear to be what you may want or ever need. God, though, is not bound by such limited sight. And being God, he is able to see the entire scope of time from beginning to end. He knows it all. And he is more than able to provide what is best for us in this world and the next. See, when I turn to Philippians today, I want to share with you the best of both worlds, because I believe this is really what Paul is trying to teach us as he is inspired of the Holy Spirit in Philippians chapter 1, verses 19 through 24. He says this, he says, "For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance, through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death." Today we magnify the name of Jesus Christ. Though this one looks to be dead, she is alive. Amen? So then it says in verse 21, and this is going to be my key verse today. "For to me," I want you to say that with me, "for to me." I want you to think about this on a personal level today. "For to me." This is what Paul says. "To live is Christ, and to die is gain." Amen? "But if I live on in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor. If I stick around a little while, I'm going to do a little bit more for the harvest. I'm going to do a little bit more for Jesus." And I think Mom was really pretty good at that. "Yet what I shall choose, I cannot tell. For I am hard pressed between the two, the living and the dying, having a desire to depart." How many times have you said, I know I say it at work, when I'm having a really bad day at work, I'm like, "Lord, take me home. Get me out of this place." I mean, that's just an honest feeling. You know, I would just rather just go on and be gone. Press between the two. "Having the desire to depart with Christ, which is far better." Amen. Finally, verse 24. "Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you." I had a hard time with this watching Dad when Dad got to the point where he couldn't no longer get out of the bed. It wasn't so bad when he could still be in a wheelchair. And then I had this hard time watching Mom kind of be the same way for a while. But the last time I saw her, she was in her wheelchair and she was able to be rolled up to the glass door so I could talk to her through the glass door. She was so upset that they wouldn't let me in, because of the coronavirus. So I had to explain to her that I couldn't come in and be with her and all those other people. And I don't know if she ever fully understood what I was saying. But I finally got her attention just enough to look at her eye to eye and say, I love you. And she looked right back at me and she says, I love you too. That was a hug through glass. Amen. I know you know what I'm talking about. And it's just amazing to me that we have to see today there's the best of this world when we stop and say, for to me, by faith, I will see what's best for me through Christ. I will see through the lens of what God wants me to see by faith. Not by sight, but by faith. That's what the Word says. The Apostle Paul insists that for him to live is Christ. The pursuit of that goal guarantees the best on earth. If he's serving him, he's always doing well. If we're praying to him and having communication with him, we will be doing well. If we're reading and studying his word, we will be doing well. When we're in a tight spot and things aren't going good and we're not happy about the situation that we're in, if we just say, hey, I believe that God can get me through anything. All things, it says. I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. This is a difficult world. I'm not trying to sugarcoat anything. I'll tell you, this is an awful world. Jesus had to die for it. He was nailed to a cross and bled and died. Because it's a tough world that needs salvation. But to have the privilege of hearing and responding to this gospel, to be received by a warm church family, that's been tough lately. Churches haven't been able to gather like they have on a normal, consistent basis. It's getting a little better, but it's been real tough. To serve the Lord. People who work in church atmospheres of even these funeral homes And I know my sister working in the nursing profession. And I'm going to tell you today, police officers, some of the best police officers I ever knew were witnesses for Jesus Christ. I had one when I was drunk as a skunk witness to me and tell me about Jesus. And I said, my mom's already told me about Jesus. I'm not living for Jesus. I know I'm a sinner and I know I'm wrong. But you know what? One day I went up there to go to the courthouse and was going to put my name on the register so I could start doing weddings in Roanoke County, and I ran into the same police officer who got me that night and brought me in for being drunk, and I told him how I changed my life, and he was like this big, and he picked me up and bear hugged me and said, hallelujah. To become a good parent, I told you this about Dad, and I'll tell you this about Mom. She wasn't perfect, but she was a good parent. She did all she could with all she had, and then some. To be a good neighbor, she was a good neighbor. She loved her neighbors. I could go on and on with stories about how she wanted to be connected to her neighbors and how she wanted to have relationships with people. She was just a people person. Even though she was a homemaker, she still reached out to her community. And to be a good citizen. She wanted to be a good citizen. She wanted to do things the right way. In order to understand what I'm talking about, when we say, for to me is live as Christ, to have the high honor of being indwelt by the Holy Spirit. My mom was real strong about the Holy Ghost thing. She believed in the Holy Ghost. She believed in being empowered by the Spirit. To know your sins are forgiven. To know that condemnation has been removed and finally that a home in heaven is waiting. This is the best the earth has to offer. Finally, in the second part of that verse, then there's the best of the next world. In verse 21 in part B, we would say like this: to live is Christ. Where's Christ living? He's at the right hand of the Heavenly Father. He's on the throne. The next time he stands up, he's calling all of his children home. It's going to be over for this world. It's going to be over for this universe. He is in heaven today, preparing a place for us, it says. In heaven, God will be able to show us the exceeding riches of his grace. Can you just imagine what a wonderful place heaven's going to be? The exceeding riches of his grace, what his blood has bought, what his blood has built, what his cross has sustained for all of us in the glories of heaven. What an experience to belong to his family here and then, to be present with him in the most personal way, when we're finally out of the old bodies and in the new bodies, how wonderful it's going to be. But we are reminded today that death is part of God's plan too. Death is in his plan. It is appointed for every man wants to die. You know, even when the rapture of the church takes place and people are being called up, they're going to die in the midst of the sky. They're going to die for a moment and then be alive again. You will die. This body will die. Removing us from this world and placing us in the next is what death can do as long as we have faith in him. As God prepared our bodies to function in this earthly environment, he will prepare us with a new body to have a new function in a heavenly environment. And we will be like Jesus. Amen. To die is gain. Amen. Amen. Had an old friend that lived to be 92 years old. She was a widow of a former pastor that pastored a church that I later pastored. She still lived in the community close to the church. And old Sister Martha, I preached a lot of these words at her funeral because she knew how to live the best of both worlds too. And she would say, "Oh, won't it be wonderful there? To have no more burdens to share." Amen. That was her favorite hymn. Amen. Amen. See? You know it. Amen. She had a heart attack. And I went in there to pray with her. And she was in the emergency room. And I said, "Martha, I thought I'd lost you." She says, "Oh, wouldn't that have been wonderful?" That's the kind of faith my mother had. You see, death will never be considered our friend. Don't get me wrong. Death is nothing to play with. I knocked on its door a few times, and I thank God that door didn't open. But it is part of God's redeeming plan to place us with himself that we too may receive the best of both of his worlds. Let us sound a note of praise in the midst of grief today. For all of God's thoughtfulness, for all of God's planning that makes our hope a reality. Jesus is real. You can doubt him. You can sling him to the side. You can ignore him. And I tell people this all the time. You can meet me and forget me. You've lost nothing. But if you meet and hear about Jesus and forget him, you've lost everything. Jesus is real. Heaven is real. Hell is real. You don't want to go to hell. You want to go to heaven. You want to be with Jesus today. Amen. All who follow Jesus Christ will be with him forever. I stated earlier that mom loved children. I know we had how many grandchildren? You remember? What's the number? I know it's like five great-grandchildren. Yeah. She would be happy, so happy to remember that. You are a blessing to her because you were born. I want to share with you just for a moment one last tribute to my mother. There was a Mother's Day message being given several years ago by a great minister. And he gave the perfect tribute to his mom. He said, "My mother practices what I preach." I believe that about my mom too. This thought is really profound. Me and my siblings are knowing this today. We are living this moment right now. The death of a loving mother is the first sorrow wept without her. You see, I want you to just stop for a moment and think about that term, mother, that God gave to all moms. That precious name, forevermore the same. Childhood's greatest word, mother. Though ages have passed and have flown by, no sound has ever known like that dear name alone, mother. From childhood's earliest day, she guarded all our way with tenderest care. She shared every woe. Each cherished hope she did know. She heard every childish prayer, no matter even if it was whispered low. Our mother, to God, to thee, in deep humility, we lift our praise to the Almighty God today. Keep those we love best, though every trial and test. Through every trial and test, through all the problems and all the change, and for all the nurture and toil, may they ever find rest, safe in thy tender care. For a God-fearing mother deserves the very best. Amen. This is my last tribute to mom with this song.
There was a home in town where broken kids, the lost and found, would come from miles around just to see what love was all about. 'Cause mama had a way of making things okay. She'd cook us our favorite meal, sit and listen to how we feel. Oh, how the pain was real. How many families would the devil steal? Mama had a way of making things okay. to believe, and in that home, love it had no end. It's where we learn to forgive. In that home, Mama always had the music on, sometimes loud, sometimes soft. When I asked about her favorite song, she opened the Bible to the book of Psalms. She always found a way to talk about grace. And in that home, we knew we were safe to be young enough to dream, find the faith to believe. In that home, love it had no end. That's where we learn to forgive. In that home, on that day I got the news that Mama's stay here was almost through. I stayed all night by her side, held her hand, looked in her eyes, and said, Mama, when you're home, I know you'll be safe, strong enough to see the faith that you believe. And in that home, life will have no end. I know I'll see you again. In that home, in that home, in that
given anything to hold her hand and hug her one last time. But I'm going to see her again. We're going to have to reserve that next hug for heaven. And I look forward to it. And I know we all do. Oh. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Spirit. We thank you for your glorious name. We glorify the name of Jesus Christ today. Joanne May Custer, born July 24th, 1934, passed away June 13th, 2020, is still alive. She's alive in Jesus. And I pray that loving Spirit will go with each and every soul. To my sister and my brother, Lord, I pray your Holy Spirit would be upon them in everything they do. To be with the grandchildren and all the great-grandchildren. Lord, we just pray for each and every relative and family member and friend that is here today. We ask that you go with us. And Lord, may we too continue to sing praises of everlasting life. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, for taking my mother home to the most beautiful home that has ever been built, your kingdom. I pray in Jesus' name, and all of God's children said amen. We will head to the graveside at Blue Ridge.